So welcome to the Urban Transportation Center, a continuing series of seminars that we host here. The Urban Transportation Center has been a research center for UIC since 1979. And we've had many esteemed guests come through our center to appear on our seminars. I've been talking to Frank Patton about the topic of today's seminar, Great Lakes Basin Railroad, before it was even called that, I think, Frank, when you first had the vision for this. And here's a guy that never says die, and he gets a vision, he follows through on it. So I thought, what better topic to bring to the center's seminar to talk about what may be one of the first new railroads in this country in a long time. That would hopefully, according to Frank's vision, help serve the network as a whole. But I won't say anything more than that, other than to point out that Frank is the managing partner of the Great Lakes Basin Railroad. Frank, this is your second or third career. I know you're
fourth or fifth.
Fourth or fifth.
You count the lemonade stands.
I know you've been an entrepreneur and been very successful in your life, and that's why you're doing what you're doing. You know how to get things that people say will never be done, done. And so he's the managing partner of the railroad. He's joined by Jim Wilson, president of the Great Lakes Railroad, Lee Hutchinson of Baytown, Steve Ernst, Scott Harper, and Jim Giblin. And Frank, I'll leave it to you.
Great,
to
I'll introduce all of them.
Introduce all of them.
Right.
And I'm sorry for those who are on the internet and cannot partake in our wonderful cookies. I'm very sorry about that. So, Frank, it's all yours.
Okay. First of all, I want to thank Steve. I want to thank the University of Illinois at Chicago, the Transportation Center. I want to thank our video technical coordinator, a gentleman by the name of Jim Limber, who is a volunteer. He's not a staff member of the UTC or the university. He's a retired electrician who worked at UIC for many years. He's done many webcasts for other UIC departments and some for the Transportation Center. And the Jim's Limber's attitude is exactly the attitude of our crew and most of the contractors and people we've talked to so far. It's not time to give up. It's time to continue to work on projects that have an impact. I also, before we get into the presentation, I want to thank the Janesville Gazette and particularly Gina Dewey and Tony Dionicchia, if I'm pronouncing it correctly. The map that is on the wall, which we're going to zoom into in a minute, they produced, and it's far better than what we have at the present time at the 75 to 100,000 foot level. I have a couple other things I want to say before we get going. We are now in the process of what we call the STB process, the Surface Transportation Board in Washington. The way, if you build a new railroad, besides doing all the preliminary work, the first thing you have to do is submit a design to the Surface Transportation Board. Ultimately, they approve it, or they approve it with conditions. When it is that approval process is finished, they take that design and submit it for bid to a number of environmental engineering firms. These firms bid on doing the environmental impact statement for the railroad. We have no input on picking which firm does that environmental impact statement. Once that statement is completed and all of the mitigation, the community meetings, the letters of interest, the discussions with the railroads, discussions with the shippers, it's a very, very thorough process. The goal at the end of that process is to get a permit to build. Once you have the permit to build, then our estimate now, our current estimate to build this railroad is going to be $6 billion. We are hopeful that we can build it between 2 and 3 calendar years. So that's the process. Our legal counsel has repeatedly mentioned to me You have to be very careful what you say when you are in the SDV process, particularly because you don't want to mislead anybody as to exactly what the route is and the property that is going to be adjoining it. We are also, and have been for several months, under very strict non-disclosures with several railroads. In fact, I can't even mention who they are. That's part of the non-disclosure. And so the things that I talk about today are things that we talked about publicly and that have been in print up to about last November. Then the NDA started taking effect. I think the purposes of this discussion we'll have plenty to talk about during the time frame. We also want to remember, have everybody remember, this venue is an undergraduate and graduate seminar. It is not a sales presentation. It's not a meeting with members of the financial community, and it's not a stockholders' annual meeting. So I'm addressing myself to the students, not only here, but to the U of I campus in Champaign, of which my wife is a graduate. I am also addressing, we know for sure that we have individuals in four continents that are going to be watching this presentation as we speak. So for all of our friends out there, we thank you for joining us. Now I've done the prologue, according to William Shakespeare, so I can get into the meat and potatoes. There are a few things that are much different with this railroad project than there are with almost anything that's ever been proposed within the last 100 years. The first is that we are asking for no subsidies, not $1, from the federal, state, or local governments. There are reasons for that. There are business reasons, and there's also my personal philosophy on who should handle this endeavor. The second one is that every piece of property on the right-of-way, and the right-of-way is basically what you can see on the screen, the purple, every piece of property that's going to be part of the right-of-way is going to have what they term in railroad circles as local rail access. That means that as part of the agreement that is signed, that if there is a carload business from that piece of property, we have to accept it. In fact, not only will we have to accept it, we will encourage it. The third piece of difference in this project is that when you have two railroads that intersect, so you have, forgive my fingers, but if you have a railroad going north and south and a railroad going east and west and the tracks coincide, then obviously one railroad has to wait for the other railroad to get through before the railroad going in the other direction can go through. There are 24 of those points on this network, and we are going to have 100% what they call in railroad terminology flyovers. That means there will be no railroad waiting for one railroad while another railroad goes through. There'll be a flyover is basically a description of a bridge over that. By doing that, you eliminate what is now a huge amount of the congestion in the Chicago terminal. And the second part of this is when you have, and this, if all you have to do is go to any downtown area, the downtowns of any of the cities in the Chicago rail terminal, where the railroad goes right down the middle of downtown, those are called grade separations. When the track is at the same level as the street, then obviously you have to have the gates come down and people have to wait till the train goes through. If you have what's called a grade separation, the train goes over the street, or in Downers Grove at the Belmont thing, it goes underneath. So those two things, the flyovers and an abundance of grade separations, mean that the congestion that happens now in the Chicago rail terminal will not happen on this network. I I have many mentors, two of which I can mention. One is Daniel Burnham, and the second one is a gentleman by the name of Judah Benjamin. Daniel Burnham, we're all familiar with in the Chicago area. He was a member of the Union League Club, as am I, and his map of highways and potential rail routes of Chicago that we have used extensively in our design was actually created in 1909. But the reason I like Mr. Burnham is I read in the book The Devil in the White City and the travails that Daniel Burnham went through on a personal level to put together the 1893 World's Fair. For anyone looking for a great read on Chicago history, that's a terrific book. The second one, Judah Benjamin, was really the guiding force in the initial stages of building the Transcontinental Railroad. And what he did is very similar to the role that I have given myself. His role in that, it's a terrific story, and it's in Stephen Ambrose's book on building the Transcontinental Railroad. I have a couple of quotes. One of them was on 60 Minutes last fall, and it was on the name of the episode was Our Failing Infrastructure. And a gentleman by the name of Richard Trumka, who was president of the AFL-CIO, said that every $1 billion spent on transportation infrastructure would create 35,000 well-paying jobs. Now, I can't validate that number. I don't know where he got it. I'm sure if you went onto the AFL-CIO website. But one of the reasons that I am the fellows that are here today with me, we've become addicted. And it's that in my lifetime, I have never had the opportunity to work on a project where the magnitude of impact could benefit so many people. So let's say that he's high. In fact, let's say he's way high. And let's say instead of the 200,000 jobs, if you do the multiplication, we just talk about 35,000 jobs. Or what if instead of 35,000 jobs, which is 1/6 of his prediction, we double it and say 70,000 jobs. So that's really what we're talking about here, is job creation and revitalizing the entire Midwest, not just Chicago. And on a personal level, these are going to be well-paying jobs so that those of us who have been blessed with children and grandchildren, where our children and their spouses have to leave Chicago because they can't find the right kind of employment. The benefits here on a personal level are also very strong, at least for me. Among the reasons why we think we will succeed, the idea of a Chicago rail bypass has been around for at least 100 years. A lot of people have tried it. To this date, nobody has succeeded. There's a quote from Victor Hugo that I think about constantly, and that is, "The mightiest army in all the world is not as powerful as an idea whose time has come." And I may be the most delusional man walking the face of the earth, but I absolutely believe that the time has come for this rail bypass. And the last one, my wife and I have lived in Crete, Illinois for 40 years in the same house, and one of our favorite places on the face of the earth is the Indiana Dunes. And when you walk to the Nature Center at the Indiana Dunes, there's a plaque there and it has the following quote from Margaret Mead. And she says, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has." Well, we are a very small group. We are growing in size. When I asked Jim Wilson to be the first president of the railroad in January, we started growing in stature. And I thank you for indulging me on this. My personal background, I spent 32 years writing software. I started an investment software firm in 1970. I sold it in 2002. And when I started all this, I said to myself, what does a computer guy have anything to do with building a railroad. And I've heard that constantly over and over when we make presentations. Lee Hutchins, who you'll meet in a minute, straightened me out as far as the idea of seeing things in networks. But I think more importantly, for people who were part of that revolution, in my own small way, a small nook of it, and got to see over and over and over again where new ideas came up, where the, quote, experts said, it'll never work, it'll cost a fortune, it'll take forever, spend some time walking on the beach, you know, you're going off on too many tangents. And over and over and over again, these ideas not only came to fruition, but they came sooner than anybody ever expected them. And they offered so much more than what the original concept was. My personal claim to fame with my business, according to Hewlett-Packard, I bought the first Hewlett-Packard laser printer in the city of Chicago. So I'm giving away my age.
Yeah. Is it still running?
Yeah, so, that's a good question. I know I can't get parts for it. So, and one of the things that I've picked up in this project, and especially now reading the histories that I read about on a day-to-day basis when I was running my software firm, is the Steve Jobs, Bill Gates whole philosophy of developing software, developing a business. And it absolutely blends in with what Margaret Mead says. One of the things I learned very early in many years ago is the worst thing you can do when you're developing a concept is to just throw a huge group of people and say, you guys figure it out. And what works is if you get four, in the software business anyway, is if you get four or five people max and you say, give us some solutions to this problem. And over again, that philosophy has come true. And so when we started this, instead of saying, okay, I've got to go out and raise zillions of dollars before we even go to square one, we started with a very small group of dedicated people, and we just kept expanding the idea and talking to people. In fact, so I don't miss anybody, Jim and I went over this in the morning a few minutes ago. We've established, I started this project in 2007, so it wasn't anywhere near what it is today. It was just an idea. Hey, wouldn't it be great if we da-da-da-da-da-da. Over that period of time, we have established what we consider not just social relationships, but working relationships, sitting down, writing memos, what works, what doesn't work, with federal, state, local officials, economic development corporations in Wisconsin, Illinois, and Indiana, business leaders in those three states, railroad industry leaders currently in the executive suite or recently retired from the executive suite, the current Class 1 railroad management, all six, and the shippers. And the route that we're going to talk about is based on the feedback from what we say is our customer base. The six Class 1 railroads and their shippers will be our customers for the Great Lakes Basin Railroad. Now what I'm going to do is walk you through the map. So if you want to just zero in on the map and make it as big as you can so everybody can see it. And again, much, much thanks to Gina and Tony at the Janesville Gazette for letting us use this map. On the west, if you start in the upper left-hand corner, you're going to see a kind of an orange line that goes from Janesville and a town called Broadhead northeast. And that is the Wisconsin and Southern Railroad that is owned by the state of Wisconsin and is currently being operated under a 50-year contract by Watco. They are operating the railroad for the owners, the state of Wisconsin. That railroad goes all through southern Wisconsin and into, through connections, the city of Milwaukee and their connections to the port of Milwaukee. So that's very, very important to say that, that we can say that our northern connection in Wisconsin leads to, either directly or indirectly, the port of Milwaukee and the railroads that serve the port of Milwaukee. Now we come down and we get to Broadhead, and this is where the Great Lakes Basin route starts. I can say categorically, we are not going through any towns, not one. In fact, we will broadly define that as not through any population centers.
How large do you think of?
What? 50? 100? What's a population center? 25?
Oh, basically any side home, that's out on a farm or whatever would be mainly away from them by 1 to 2 miles.
Right. So, long way away. For some, not long enough. And we acknowledge that. Okay, so we come down south, and we come west of Rockford, and then, and we're going to hear more about Rockford in a few minutes, then we go east and south, and then east again, and the line that looks like it's on the DeKalb-Ogle County line is actually 2 miles east of I-39. And then it comes south, and then in LaSalle County, it goes east at to Grundy County, where our second river crossing, the Illinois River, crosses. We actually have three, we're going to have three river bridges, the Rock River, the Illinois River, and the Kankakee River. Then we cross the Illinois River, and we come down south. That little spur there is a proposed spur into the Coal City Manifest Terminal that Union Pacific and Coal City is now developing. And we wanted to offer that spur in addition to the track that is already going in, so there won't be a problem of interacting with different railroads. Then the line goes southeast into Kankakee County, crossing the Kankakee River. Then it goes northeast. There's a spur in Kankakee to some industrial properties that are in Kankakee County, so we wanted to add that. Then it goes straight east, and that line is, obviously it's not to scale, and I should say this right off the bat. The purple line is not to scale. If it was, we'd be asking for 40 or 50 miles of right-of-way. We're asking for 200 feet. Okay, that's less than two tennis courts added to each other. Okay, so we go up to the Will County, Kankakee County line. The spur going north is a proposed spur into the South Suburban Freight Airport. And Jim Giblin can say a few words on that later. We then come south. It continues and goes east and then southeast, several miles south of Lowell, Indiana. And we've had many conversations with people from that area, including some representatives in the Indiana legislature from that area. We're very comfortable with at least that broad route. Then we go northeast and we connect at mile 240 on I-65. And there are several reasons for doing that, which either later or at some other discussion we can explain why. Then from I-65, we stay west of Hebron and connect with what's called in Indiana the Old Monon. And this is actually a right-of-way that 50 or 60 years ago, is that fair? When it was, Jim, when was the Old Monon built?
I think in the early 80s.
Abandoned in the early 80s. So we're going to connect with that. We're going to go north all the way into Michigan, west of Michigan City, and then that spur to the east. And Jim Olson and I were there yesterday for almost 4 hours with the Kingsbury Industrial Logistics Park. So that's the basic route. The size is going to range from 275 to 285 miles, depending on where the bridge placement is, and that's exactly what we're working on right now. Where do we put the bridges? So that's the route. And again, I want to repeat that every piece of property on the route is going to have local rail access. The long-term goal, and by long-term I mean the first year of operations, what we want to do is to have a daily shuttle. And the shuttle, there'll be two starting points. One will be up in Wisconsin, and the second will be at the Port of Chicago. And the idea is, within 24 hours, anything that has to get to the lakes or anything that comes off the lakes can be sent on its way and not sitting in some kind of a yard for 1 to 7 to 10 days. So that's critical to this whole design. And again, I want to stress that this is not Jim and Frank and his friends sitting in a saloon on a napkin doing drawings. This is a result of feedback from all of the groups that I've mentioned. Now I'm going to turn it over to Jim Wilson. He accepted my offer to be the first president of Great Lakes Basin Railroad in January. He has 37 years experience in the railroad industry, 18 of which were working for the old Santa Fe Railroad, which is now part of the Burlington Northern Santa Fe Railroad that's owned by Berkshire Hathaway. Jim's going to walk you through some of the specific rail-orientated issues. Jim? And can you see him okay?
Yeah. Thank you, Frank. It's a pleasure to be with everybody this afternoon, and thank you for coming. Frank addressed the what. What makes up the idea for the Great Lakes Basin Railroad? And I'd like to talk about why. Why should this happen? Why is it important to the region and even to the United States? In my experience in the railroad industry, it's my 18 years with Santa Fe, I was in charge of service design, system operations, center, all the train dispatching, all the locomotive dispatching, and had several different positions with the company involving technology, automotive operations, different pieces of the pie that makes a railroad run on a daily basis. Then I spent 19 years consulting in the industry and operations and technology. So a lot of that has been spent in the Chicago region. I was on the team that did the first operating study on the CREATE project. And so I've been involved with this deeply for decades now, which is I'm finally starting to learn something about Chicago. But when you look at there's been several studies done over the past 5 years about traffic flows for both automotive, for vehicle traffic in this region, for national basis, for rail traffic and truck traffic, to see what the future is going to look like. And for us, in the next 10 to 20 years, it's crowded, it's oversold, it's overbooked. And so we have to look at different ways to deal with railroad traffic and automotive traffic here in this region. So looking at that, on a macro basis for the United States, the growth in population will be in the Midwest, the East, and the South. With some, of course, in the West Coast, but it centers around where good weather is, where manufacturing is, where different economic factors come into play. And for us in Chicago, we enjoy being the railroad hub, the largest freight railroad hub in the world. So if it's moving through from east to west and some north to south, Chicago is one of the biggest inflection points that we deal with. And with Chicago proper itself, there's not enough room for the railroads to grow their right-of-way, to grow their capacity, to handle what the future is bringing to us. They forecast that by 2040 that our region's freight traffic for rail will grow by 80%. That can't be handled. that doesn't allow for growth opportunities for Metra, for Amtrak, for the freight railroads to handle what's going to happen, to handle our population. Also, in that arena, for Chicago itself, the region growth of population is about 2 million people. So that takes more cars, more trucks, more railroad capacity to handle just supporting our area, plus the throughput it takes to handle the rest of the country. So we look at the status of our rail hub here in Chicago. In 2013 and 2014, the railroads, in some cases over several months, were at capacity or greater. They couldn't put the throughput through here that we needed. So they've taken some measures on their own to try and move traffic around the city, to change different mixes and outlooks, but they still have issues with handling that even now. So with this growth coming on, it's not going to happen. So this, if you look at Chicago on a micro basis, Crane's forecasted in 2015 there would be 8,700 apartments developed and added to Chicago. So with 8,700 apartments, if you have two people an apartment, that's 17,400 people that all need food, groceries, toilet paper, and anything it takes to sustain them. If everybody had one car, that's 8,700 cars. Well, 8,700 cars come by rail to the Chicago region. That's 580 carloads of automobiles just to take care of that little inflection point of dealing with our population. So you have to think logistically what's going to happen and how to take care of that. So looking at Chicago, there's 25% of the railroad traffic in Chicago that does not belong here because it doesn't terminate here, doesn't originate here. And so what we're looking is to bypass that traffic around the Chicago region, giving the railroads an outlet for that traffic. They would have to change how they block things, how they move things. We would be an outlet to handle that. And we can do that by these 24 intersection points that we have for interchange to move traffic around through the city and not into the city like it is now. The other thing that happens when we have looked at this and talked with our prospective customers is we're going to deliver five key themes for this region. We're going to improve safety of rail movement of traffic. We'll improve the velocity of traffic. We'll improve the capacity to move traffic through here and have the capacity to grow within the next 100 years. And the reliability of our physical plant and the way we'll provide service to our customers will be one of our biggest focuses. The other thing we do is with that imprint of 275 miles of new railroad is we also allow for a new logistics belt around Chicago for warehousing, distribution, and manufacturing. We'll be able to serve directly by rail. We'll also be able to provide intermodal service and truck access to this area. Everything's going to grow, everything has to evolve. It all still works in partnerships. There's still competition between modes, and all that will still stay in place. But we give a safety valve to the region to grow. Frank addressed the safety issue involved by having the flyovers not intersecting with the railroads at grade, and also separating ourselves from the traffic and from the streets and the highways in the region. That would be a big key to providing that. Plus, we'll build a physical plant that will be second to none and have the technology in place to do the detection of defects and set trends and provide ways to improve safety as we focus on that. Velocity and speed. If you look at the region, it takes 24 to 36 hours to move it car through town. If everything works right, we'll be able to do movement of bypassing traffic in 8 hours. So that velocity adds up to more capacity for the railroads to utilize their locomotives, crews, and cars even better than they do today. The capacity by putting in two main tracks and having the ability to grow to six main tracks in heavy traffic areas will bode well for the region for decades. The reliability as we design and build this stretch of railroad, we'll be focusing on the lowest amount of grades, the areas where we don't have water issues, where we don't have snow issues, and to be ready to take on what comes with running a railroad. It's an all-outdoor contact sport 24/7. The revenue, we also provide revenue opportunities to the railroads themselves with the logistics ring. The velocity, when I've been out talking to shippers in my railroad career, they're in a railroad shipper who said they can't ship more unless the market's telling them something else. But the ability to turn our assets faster and give more opportunities to those customers will be a boon for the railroads and for the region. So for those reasons, that's why I'm enthused about this project and look forward to executing it and getting in operation. And we appreciate your support as we go forward.
Great. Thank you, John. Our next, most of the meetings that Dr. Lee Hutchins and I have had are at the Starbucks in Millennium Station, because when he's catching his train and I'm catching mine, we intersect. So we say, let's sit down for an hour and compare what's happened in the last couple of days or last week or so. Dr. Lee Hutchins wrote his PhD dissertation on urban rail investments. He's one of the stellar performers for AECOM, which is the largest engineering firm in the world by revenue. I think they have, was it at least 300 full-time rail employees?
Oh, over there now, in North America.
Yeah, just in North America. Lee gets the credit. The first time I sat down and went through this with him, he looked right at me and he said, this is not a railroad, it's a network. And you have to start thinking in those terms. So with that, I'm going to turn over to Lee.
Thanks, Frank. I had the good fortune to meet Frank about a year and a half ago, and as we started talking about the idea and what it meant, it's one of those things where you can look at transportation from a couple perspectives. Oftentimes, we look at it from existing conditions. Is it things are congested? Is there some access thing you want to solve? But occasionally, you can look at it and say, this brings a whole different answer to the equation. And all the historical transportation maps in the United States and North America, for that matter, as well as Google Earth, will show the greatest density of railroad lines virtually anywhere in the world are here in Chicago. It's based on historical development, historical transportation, freight movements across North America have the concentration here. So it becomes, what is the solution? And Frank's initial idea of more of just the east-west segment that's on the board there really grew into one that connects all the way around the region and enables freight traffic to move. And we see similar pieces of this in the railroad's own investments, the Norfolk Southern with their Crescent Corridor that links Memphis and New Orleans with the Northeast, enables transportation and industries to access their network and move up and down the Crescent, whichever direction they want to go, by virtue of that connection. Well, you have similar things with the BNSF on their double track between Chicago and LA. You have individual gateways that CSX has looked at, say, for North Baltimore, what the Union Pacific has done for their Dupo Yard outside of St. Louis, as well as what they're doing in Joliet and initially the BNSF Logistics Park, where they've looked at their individual network that they have for transportation, say, we need to enhance this corridor, we need to enhance this gateway with the investments that we make. Well, Frank was the first person to bring this idea forward to say, what does this network need? It was not really the piece that any individual railroad would touch, but the overall network had the degree of congestion and freight coming together the mixtures that the railroads bring of through and local traffic to get it here gives us an opportunity to begin to separate that and work with each of the railroads on how they might use the network today or give them chances to look at how they might use the network differently in the future by presenting this bypass alternative around Chicago. So really it became a discussion very quickly about this is what the network could perform differently and yet complement all the activities that are underway here right now, the investments that the railroads have with the logistics activity. As Jim mentioned, the number of shippers that had said, we can move more material, we just can't get it through here right now. The network improvement gives you that kind of an opportunity. So in some ways, Great Lakes Basin Railroad looks like a brand new idea, but on the other hand, it's very consistent with what railroads have done with pieces of their own overall network and corridors that they have. It's just applied on a more localized scale, in part because of all the localized railroad connections and traffic that exists in the Chicago area. I think the other piece that has brought the interest by a number of parties to the whole Great Lakes Basin Railroad is the fact that this northeast Illinois, northwest Indiana, southeast side of Wisconsin brings us into a marketplace of 65 to 70 million people in a 4 to 5 hour driving time from Chicago. Virtually any other port or railroad center around the globe doesn't quite have that. Even your large ports like Rotterdam or Antwerp in Europe, Singapore in the Far East, even along China, most of those are located with markets to just one side. So again, when you improve this transportation and reduce congestion, you at the same time get improved access to a marketplace that is substantial to start with. So all these things begin to support the overall idea as you look at this from just a network perspective, not just reducing congestion in one particular market. So anyway, it's a real pleasure to speak with you here today. When I was sitting in a room similar to this, working on my dissertation a number of years ago on relocating rail yards in urban areas, I didn't know I'd get the chance to revisit it here again. So it's a real pleasure to be here.
One real blessing that Lee has in his life is he wrote a dissertation, and then as soon as it was published, he started using it on a day-to-day basis. And I'm sure if he was asked, can you write a follow-up, he could do it quickly.
I would love to do it, actually. You could get it probably done in a long weekend versus carrying card decks to computer center. So.
Okay, the next, we're trying to do this on a logical basis. About a year ago, Lee called me and said, I've got a friend of mine from Rockford who's going to be in the city, and I think you should meet him. And so I went over and we had lunch, and the gentleman that I met is Steve Ernst, who is down there. Can you see him okay?
Yeah.
The lighting's all right?
It's okay.
Great. He's wearing a bright yellow shirt. Steve, we'll give you a little bit of his background, but Steve was the voice, along with several others, but on a very, very pointed basis of saying, you have to come to Rockford, you have to go to into Wisconsin, and you have to end up in Michigan City to make this a network. And he and Lee convinced Jim and I and several others that this was not a 20-year plan. Like most 20-year plans, they never get built. There's always reasons, always we should have, we looked at it then. And so we made the decision that we're going to do the whole thing at once. And so we're not going to say this is phase one, phase two, and phase three. This is a 275 to 285 mile network. And when we submit our drawings to the Surface Transportation Board for design approval, it will be for the entire network. Steve, you want to talk about how this affects Rockford? We've been pretty Chicago-centered. So now we're going to talk about Rockford and some of the outlying areas.
Just a little bit on my background.
I was originally hired back in the day from the Rockaway-Bagel County Planning Commission as a transportation planner and civil engineer. That organization folded 3 years after I started, became the city's traffic engineer, and did the transportation planning piece of it kind of as a second job. That lasted about 25 to 27 years, and then I transferred over. In Chicago, you have CMAP, which used to be CATS. Well, in Rockford, you now have RMAP, which used to be RATS. We made the transition from RATS to RMAP. I came out as a full-time executive director of that, and recently retired in December of last year. But as part of the work that I had done in transportation, really goes all the way back to the early 80s. As you may remember, Rockford was the hardest hit in the nation for unemployment during that that recession, more than 25% unemployment. And out of that catastrophe came a directive that our industrial heritage in machine tool and automotive assembly needed to be diversified, and diversified considerably. Because of our presence of where Interstate 39 and Interstate 90 come together and the US 20 corridor that goes over to Mississippi, we were fortunate that freight and logistics companies started looking at Rockford because of its position related to its highways. And so we spent a considerable amount of time, you know, working on economic development potential around freight and logistics. In the early 90s, I had the good fortune to meet Dr. Lee Hutchins. And we started talking about doing the same thing with rail, that we really needed a rail plan. And the rail plan needed to look at not only the rail assets, but also needed to look at the land use adjacent to the rail and to try and take advantage of new economic development opportunities along those rail corridors. If you're familiar with CREATE in Chicago, we have something I generally refer to as CREATE Light or even CREATE Ultralight. But its focus wasn't really because we didn't have the passenger rail conflicts that we have in Chicago. We really were concentrated on the economic development potential adjacent to those rail corridors. And so in about 1993, we completed that plan. And the idea was to create a solid north-south and solid east-west rail corridor that was improved that could provide some economic development around freight using rail. One of the problems that we have, though, is that the legacy rail yards, two of the class ones, I guess technically all three of the class ones at Sir Rockford plus one short line railroad, their rail yard facility is in downtown Rockford, in a spot that's probably not conducive for rail business, but also not conducive for the changes that are going on in downtown Rockford. I also was responsible for the planning around the restoration of passenger rail, and so we're looking at a downtown rail facility for passengers. And the idea was to take the land where the legacy freight yards is and convert that to transit-oriented development. If we could find a location that was suitable for the railroads for cargo-oriented development. And, you know, it was obvious amongst the transportation professionals as well as the economic development folks that we dealt with that a location closer to the Rockford Airport probably made the most sense. The problem was we really didn't have an idea of exactly where it would go and what it would look like. And then enter the Great Lakes Basin Railroad. And it kind of all got crystallized very quickly. Because we're now talking about bringing a rail facility true north-south on the western edge of Rockford. And if I can just point, the airport is in this notch right here. So literally the Great Lakes Basin touches the airport property. Back in early 2000s, the city of Rockford annexed two large farm parcels and zoned them for industrial development. They're referred to as Gensler and Wolfenberger, the two owners of those properties. But they are perfectly situated to allow light and heavy industrial land use to be created. And now we are a little more mature in our planning, but we actually have a design that takes the Great Lakes Basin through those properties at an angle, which gives us about 9,000 feet of storage for a rail facility. And really creates, I think, what we like to be referred to as the Rockford Terminal. And I think it makes a whole lot of sense for the network that we're talking about to be able to utilize that terminal, not only to connect with the logistics corridor that's rapidly occurring in I-39. Once Union Pacific built World 3 down in Rochelle, and you start to see some of the transformation that's happening along I-90, you start to see some opportunity with a terminal that can access Interstate 39 and US 20 to, going over towards the Mississippi. So the original plan, which was really a consolidation plan with a north, south, and east, west, now is more of a network with a loop. And we believe that we can add to the idea of increasing velocity for freight. Rockford's freight that is being born there is really, you know, carload style freight. We don't really have anything other than that. So the Great Lakes Basin kind of provided us an opportunity to germinate a seed for that kind of business. And we are starting to entertain companies that are doing things like fulfillment centers. We'd love Amazon to consider a fulfillment center in Rockford, but it probably isn't going to happen. Probably closer to Chicago if it happens. But that style of just-in-time business is now becoming something we can offer not only our highway network towards, but we can also offer potentially rail service. We don't see much interface with the air cargo that's happening at the airport now, but I think that's something we'd like to continue to pursue. The area where that terminal would be built, it's got some great assets to go along with it. There are three industrial recovery TIFs and 7,000 acres of land. The airport has an international gate for the U.S. Customs Port of Entry. There's also Foreign Trade Zone number 176, which allows duty-free or reduced tariff activity. And then, of course, you've got the I-39 corridor and the footprint that's now served by rail. So all those things kind of came together. I was very pleased that Frank seems to have the momentum continuing. You know, we certainly like to be a part of that. And I'm really happy that you invited me to be here.
Great. Well, we're one of the fears when you do a project like this, when you go into Wisconsin or Rockford or in northwest Indiana and some of the very small towns, you always want to make sure everybody understands this is a region effort. The region is Wisconsin, Illinois, and Indiana. It only works if there's cooperations between the region. One of the estimates that we heard from one of our contractors is that within 2 or 3 years, 5 at the most, every major shipper in North America will be on this route. And that's where the job predictions come from. I'm quoting him. In fact, Lee heard it. Every single shipper, major shipper in North America. I now want to introduce my next one of our associates is a gentleman by the name of Scott Harper. For those of you who have followed this concept, like Steve, it was originally part of what was called the Illiana Expressway project. In the beginning, the corridor, the Illiana Expressway corridor, was 2,000 feet by 47 miles. And my original idea was there's plenty of room to build a railroad. Well, as it turns out, the proposed highway is not in a straight line, so there wasn't enough room to put in a railroad. And so in 2013, we separated. We now have no relationship with the Ileana Highway Project at all. We certainly have our views like everyone else, but that's, and during that period is when I met Scott Harper. I had a very warm relationship with David Vaught, who was head of the Office of the Budget for the state of Illinois, and one of his number one assistant was Scott Harper. And then David moved to the Office of Economic Development for the state of Illinois for a period of months. And so Scott and I started working even more closely together on this. Scott's last assignment was with the Illinois Department of Natural Resources, and he's got some very strong ideas that I completely agree with on how this railroad will interface with different areas that are of particular interest to the environmental groups.
And just, I forgot to mention, we would like to reserve some time for Q&A.
Yeah.
Which is what a seminar.
So these last two
exchange of ideas between the audience and
okay.
Those who are presenting.
So if you could speed it up.
Okay, well, I can do it in 5 minutes. In addition to working for government, where I met Frank, I have also a career as a successful entrepreneur and an international logistics expert. So this project is near and dear to my heart on a number of fronts. I'm going to be talking about my role in working with the environmental groups and the environmental impact study, which follows the STB initial approval step. So I want to talk to you about four things: principles that Great Lakes Basin has when it comes to the environment, main benefits, plans, and then a couple of specific issues. On principles, there are three of them: safety, avoidance, and being a positive force. Safety's been mentioned particularly with regard to the flyovers and the grade separations, and Jim alluded to this briefly, but the highest caliber of track and rail bed, what's known as Class 5. The other part of safety when it comes to cargo that doesn't need to unload in Chicago, for example, volatile oil from the Bakken Shale that has had derailments and subsequent explosions in Canada and then recently in Galena, south of Galena. That cargo does not need to come through Chicago. It does not need to threaten. I mean, admittedly, it's driving at about 2 miles an hour when it comes through Chicago because of all the congestion problems. One of the main tracks happens to come right by the window of my condo, so I see hundreds of oil tank cars every day on the rail that goes out to Hinsdale and Naperville. So safety is one thing. Then avoidance of any areas of environmental concern. There are three in particular that I'm going to mention at the end, but as well as any area that has a threatened wildlife population or plant biology population, we are going to be working proactively as well as through the formal process of the environmental impact process to avoid and change the route in some tactical way when change the main outline probably would fit within the boundaries of the drawing, but to avoid any kind of threatened or endangered species. But then beyond those two things, we want to be a positive force. Jim mentioned the multimodal and freight, and so did Steve, the multimodal freight industrial development potential of this. When I talk to the environmentalists, some of them also get that, but from their point of view, it amounts to environmental and even residential sprawl. So we're going to work with them as proactively as we can to shepherd some of that development into specific corridors so that the roads can handle it, so that it doesn't create this orgy of need for new highways and need for new surface roads, but can still get the benefit of all these great jobs that Jim and Frank have talked about. Main benefits, what are we, from an environmental perspective, that is, from the economic development perspective, it's pretty compelling. But there are also compelling environmental benefits. Trucks off the road. Our estimate is that we can relieve the roads of up to 1 million trucks a year by offering the timeliness and the utilization that Jim mentioned will enable a new round of just-in-time delivery by rail instead of having to rely on trucks for the last 500 miles. A second one I already alluded to, safety for the population centers for dangerous cargo. We also don't unload any coal or grain at the moment in Chicago, so we can offload those cargoes. But the big one that I think environmentalists, but also general citizens, will be excited about is taking the oil cargoes, for which they're presumably will not be additional pipeline capacity for some time and will necessitate the use of rail. We can get that cargo off out of the center of the city of Chicago. What are we doing? We're working with environmental groups proactively. We're avoiding areas of environmental concern. And as I mentioned, working to prevent sprawl. And this work is ongoing and then will accelerate as we get our initial STB permission to proceed into the environmental impact statement, or survey rather. Specific issues that I want to mention. There are three big national areas of public land, let's say it that way. One is the Hackmatack National Wildlife Refuge, which was recently established. Everybody in this room might not even know of its existence because it hasn't been broadly publicized. But our railroad is well to the west of that. It straddles the Wisconsin-Illinois border and Walworth and McHenry counties in particular, but I think it goes a little bit into Kenosha and White counties. So we're well west of that, but that is a massive new wildlife refuge that will gradually build as property is acquired. There's some initial properties in this wildlife sanctuary, and it's one of it's the latest designated national wildlife refuge. Similar to that is the Medewan National Tallgrass Prairie, which is in Will County, south and east of Joliet. And you can see that we're avoiding Will County for other reasons besides the Medewan, but that is a great thing from a open space point of view that we're skirting the Medewan National Prairie. And then a new initiative, and I just talked to the federal official at the National Wildlife Service last night, and this is not exactly ready for prime time, but I can say this much, that the Fish and Wildlife Service is projecting a new national designation for a wildlife sanctuary and ecosystem protection. The Kankakee Sands is a very unique ecosystem. The oak savanna in a dune-like environment is a kind of environment that doesn't exist very, very widely across the globe and worthy of protection. So we are we're actually going north of that, the proposed boundaries of that, and want to. You know, I told John last night that we would seek to avoid it if there's any areas that they think they might want to acquire in the future. The fourth thing, special project that I'd like to mention, and that Frank asked me specifically to mention, is called Millennium Reserve. And this is not designated on the map, but it's the south side of Chicago and the south suburban area. The Millennium Reserve is an initiative of, again, the Fish and Wildlife Service of the federal government in partnership with the Department of Natural Resources, the City of Chicago, the Forest Preserve District of Cook County, and many private groups, industrial and nonprofit, designed to invigorate the south side of Chicago from a cultural standpoint, from a natural standpoint, and from a jobs and economic development standpoint. It turns out that even with all the steel mills and with all the rail corridors and all the highways, that this area on the south side of Chicago, but along the shore of the lake, still has an amazing amount of environmental diversity. It's a bird sanctuary and wetlands. It's naturally a wetland. If we didn't drain the area for farming or for preventing floods in residential areas, it would revert back to a wetland. So we are going to be involved in that with the Indiana Harbor Belt Rail, and Frank mentioned earlier access to the Port of Chicago and the daily train that will come, or two really, one from the port and one to the port. We are interacting with and stakeholders in the Chicago Millennium Reserve.
Great.
Thank you very much.
If I could just clarify one thing, sorry, on the Galena incident that took place a couple months ago. I think it was just a release. I don't think there was any fire explosion.
No, there was a fire.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I didn't know.
I thought I saw huge pictures of flames.
Oh, it was huge. Yeah. It was huge. It burned for 5 to 6 days.
Right.
Yeah.
And all you have to do is think what would happen if that was somewhere else. Okay, the last, and then we'll open up for questions. Jim Giblin.
This will be a real 5 minutes, right?
Yeah. Sorry, Scott.
Is that not 5 minutes?
Jim Giblin also has been in the rail logistics industry, I think for as long as Jim Wilson has, 37 years. He worked at Santa Fe. He also worked at Transsystems, which Transsystems actually modeled some of our speed models to make sure.
Let me start with the program.
Okay.
A couple of very quick things. One thing that Frank did not mention in his original presentation is that we do have the first federal official who came out in support of the railroad. He's a good friend of mine. A woman that the Sun-Times referred to as Rockin' Robin when she won the congressional election that I helped get her through, Congresswoman Robin Kelly of the 2nd District of Illinois. She has been the first federal official to publicly come out in support of the bypass railroad. Secondly, when I was at Transsystems, we did a project for a company up in Wisconsin. I can't tell you who they are, but their headquarters were designed by Frank Lloyd Wright, located in Racine, and they made all kinds of wonderful consumer products, but you didn't hear the name from me. They are a very forward-thinking company, and they are sort of in the vanguard of companies today which are trying to, the exact terminology is decarbonize their supply chain, look for ways to, on their own, to reduce their carbon footprint as they go to deliver product. What we did for these folks, they are a very large user of intermodal. They've done the easy stuff first. They've switched from truck to intermodal. Good for them. God bless them. The problem is they still have a gazillion trucks running up and down I-294 between Racine County and intermodal terminals in Chicago. So what they had us do was actually look at the feasibility of constructing and operating an intermodal terminal in Racine County, in the lovely town of Sturtevant, and see if it was feasible to ship product direct out of Sturtevant on the rail as opposed to coming down Chicago. Short version of it is, it was on the cusp, marginal at best, but one of the problems we had was getting the stuff around Chicago, particularly going to the west. For those of us who are Chicago-centric and, you know, think of Wisconsin as the great coal wasteland to the north, there's a surprising amount of medium heavy industry, a lot of consumer products, manufacturing companies located in southeastern Wisconsin. A lot of people who would ship by truck, intermodal, who are perfect for this type of a network. And I doubt that we would ever have a service that would be competitive going from Wisconsin to the east, but we certainly have the ability to set up a service that would go from Wisconsin to the west, coming down through Janesville and utilizing the existing Union Pacific facility at Rochelle, which if you know anything about that, it was designed as an intermodal terminal. It's had a lot of success as a transload terminal, but as an intermodal terminal, it still has a lot of capacity. So the ability to work cooperatively with our friends in Wisconsin with a true public-private partnership to build an intermodal terminal up there, to run intermodal out of Wisconsin to the west, and to bypass Chicago with, you know, anywhere from 1,000 to God knows how many thousands of trucks, intermodal containers per day, is one of the more interesting things. And it's sort of ironic, my first railroad job was with the Chicago Northwestern back in 1978, and in 1979 we were actually looking at trying how to do intermodal out of Milwaukee to the West Coast. So, you know, everything old is new, or new is old, whatever. That's my story and I'm sticking to it.
Thanks.
Great.
Thank
you.
Okay, let's open up for questions.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, for those who just joined us after the start, and here in the room and also on the internet, I'm Steve Schlicking, the Executive Director of the Urban Transportation Center. And hopefully most of you have heard this very interesting and hopeful story about improving the rail network, not just for Illinois, but possibly for the nation. I'd like to start off the questioning myself for you. So we have this other program called CREATE, it's been referred to, and Jim referred to political support. What does this railroad mean to the principals in CREATE? I mean, City of Chicago, Rahm Emanuel, Illinois Department of Transportation, from Governor Rahmer, the Metra, Commuter Rail, and we say the RTA. How do you convince them that this is something they should support?
Actually, the initial effort was done by a study that was financed by the Chicago Department of Transportation in 2003. And their conclusion was this 25% through traffic, which is anywhere from 100 to 150 trains a day. It doesn't have to be in Chicago. And we're talking about the big four, oil, ethanol, coal, and grain. There is no reason for a unit train of those four products to go through Chicago. And the study said, let them go. And if you let them go, don't force them out, if you let them go, what you do is free up that capacity that doesn't exist today for what Chicago can do well. And that is for the lifting and the blocking for things that have to come into the city. And we can, if we had a lot of time, we could say examples of shippers who are now bypassing Chicago, going all the way down to St. Louis and Memphis because of the congestion here. So, a gentleman from the Association of American Railroads told me in August, we complement CREATE because we offer a way to get the traffic that doesn't have to be in Chicago, out of Chicago.
And that helps speeds up the commuter rail.
Speeds up the whole commuter rail system.
And you know, you should know better because I think you participated in several of these studies. This is not the first time.
I'm just here to be
the
foil.
Does that mean he doesn't know the answer?
Yeah, exactly.
I've done this out. I deliberately brought it with us today. Frank talked about the study done for the City of Chicago. This was actually the Metropolitan Planning Council of Chicago that did the Regional Freight Action Agenda that was published in April of 2002. This is sort of the original modern bypass, which talked about using the EJ&E as a bypass, which is essentially what Frank is doing, only he's moved it from the Chicago suburbs about 60 or 90 miles further out of the city and south of the city. I would also point out, from the historical perspective, there was a gentleman by the name of Ben Heinemann, a Chicago lawyer, who took over the Chicago Northwestern Railroad in the mid-50s and modernized their commuter rail network. Ben Heinemann tried to do this himself in the early 1950s after he gained control of the Minneapolis and St. Louis Railroad. He tried to buy the Toledo, Peoria, and Western Railroad and also the Monon Railroad. And the right-of-way that Frank wants to use from Michigan City South would have been part of Ben Heinemann's original Chicago Bypass Railroad. So this is not you know, the old story about everything old is new or new is old. Yeah, I think your name is in here somewhere, by the way. But this study, the City of Chicago study, the work that we did at CMAP, and we put together the 2040 plan, the genesis of what Frank is doing has been around for a long time, and it should not come as a shock to people like Mayor Emanuel that, you know, this thing has suddenly popped up again.
Thank you.
The other thing about this creek needs to be finished just to take care of the capacity that's needed for now. It's already way behind the curve on what should have happened and should have been in place. It's still needed regardless of what we do and what the future is.
Okay, and we support it, and I have said that publicly. Good. And been quoted.
Good, great. I'd like to open this up to others to ask questions. If you, when I call on you, please give us your name and your affiliation. David, who's one of my students, I'm going to give him priority.
That's my name. I work for UTC. Is this proposal in terms of, is it going to be an operating entity, or is it going to be an entity that owns the track and leases trackage rights?
Combination thereof.
Okay.
We originally looked at ourselves as a toll railroad to parallel the toll road that was going to be there. And after we started meeting with our targeted customers, we found out right away that they want us to run a railroad and a service and handle their, move their freight with their locomotives and their trains from point A to point C. And however the mix of point of interchanges works for traffic moving, they want us to provide the service.
And one of the interesting things I found out was that railroad, these are the six class ones, railroad A would want us to do certain things. Railroad B says, well, we can understand why they want you to do that, but we want you to do that, plus this is what we want you to do for us. And then railroad C says, well, gee, as long as you're doing it for them, then this is what we'd like, you know, and it just keeps building. That's what's so fascinating about this whole project, is now that you've got this, where can you go with it? Which I'll address in my final comments.
Yes.
Yeah, hi, I'm Dr. Laura Chamberlain, and I represent some community groups from around this area, and we're big environmentalists. So my questions, I'll just shoot through them.
I'm sorry, could you limit yourself to one question so we can let everybody have a chance to ask their questions as well?
Darn, there's just three parts. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and ask, and they can decide. So we want to know if there's going to be union jobs with this railroad. Number two, we want to know if you're going to be, it sounds like it might put a lot of truckers out of business, and are you going to be going to that demographic for hiring first? And number three is, we're very concerned about the oil spills that might occur with the crude oil over our waterways. So you have three rivers, and what are you doing to reinforce those bridges or to stop that possibility? And the fourth is, we're also concerned about chlorine gas. Are you going to be moving that on this and out of Chicago?
Okay, short answers, please.
Okay, first short answer, the Surface Transportation Board tells the railroads what they have to move. And unless they say, don't move this, you have to move it. You don't have a choice. There are 6,000, Jim and I went to a presentation, there are approximately 6,000 chemicals that are shipped by rail, most of which we never even hear of. All I can say is we're getting those out of the metropolitan areas. Truckers, Jim?
There's actually a shortage of truck drivers. A very considerable shortage of truck drivers in Chicago, and more importantly in the Midwest region. I have a good friend who's Vice President of Operations here in the Midwest with J.B. Hunt, and he likes this program because while he has enough drivers within the city and the metro area, he is short drivers in Wisconsin and short drivers in Iowa to bring intermodal loads between those areas in Chicago. So the trucking industry is going to love this because they are short people already, and that's a demographic shortage that is only going to get worse, not better.
Union jobs.
Union jobs. My father-in-law was president of his union at the IHB. I am totally committed to that environment.
The other thing on bridge design, we are going to look at bridges totally different than the industry does now. and we were very cognizant that the waterways would be over. We'd want to do something to make those bridges to where if there's a derailment, there's spill on those, there's some way to contain it, manage it. The issue becomes always with these things is a way to, time is your enemy when something happens. Getting the right equipment, the right things there, and the right people in place and mitigate these things. We need to be proactive in our design and how we look at things to start with to give ourselves the best.
So you're going to have a big old oil pan?
A big what?
You're going to have a big old oil pan under the bridge?
something, some way to look at it that's different than it's been done before.
Okay. And I should mention, I think these guys will be here after the meeting in case we don't get...
Oh yeah, we'll be here. If anybody, after the 1:30 cutoff, we'll stick around as long as you want.
So this gentleman right here, who are you and what's your affiliation and what's your question?
Dr. Rendick, I'm just transportation and retired. I had a question about why are you avoiding Will County and what is that yellow line in the top northwest quadrant there?
Okay, the yellow line is the Wisconsin and Southern Railroad, and Will County, we didn't want to interfere with the building of the airport or the building of the Iliana Expressway. And the expressway design is about 2 miles north of the county line. And when you design a railroad and there's a major highway, the metaphor is a potbelly stove. You want to be close enough to soak up the heat, but not so close you burn your fingers. And so we think the right distance is about 3 miles, which means we have to be in Kankakee County. The land down there is absolutely terrific. In fact, a gentleman from the EPA who is now retired told me from the value of the kind of land, he thought the highway should even be in Kankakee County. The highway should have been in Kankakee County.
Because there's too much wetlands in
there? It's flatter. It's, you know, I'm not a geologist, but when I told him we wanted to put the railroad, he said, that's terrific, I'll support you, this is how long it's going to take to get the EIS, da-da-da-da-da-da, and he said, this will be around for 100 years. And we've heard that from the Class 1s as well. And that's why we're in this, because the impact is not something that's going to go away. The impact will be literally for generations, and I heard that in two big meetings with the Class 1 railroads. This one gentleman said, for once, we're going to build something that's going to last 100 years, not to try and modify something that was built 100 years ago.
Ken Dahlmeyer, how much of this is going to be on existing railroad right-of-way versus on dying new?
It's 100%
new. 100%
new. Yeah.
So therefore, you're going to probably need some condemnation capabilities?
We think the package that we're going to offer the landowners, we've already test marketed it, quote unquote, and it got a terrific response. Ultimately, the railroads have eminent domain. It goes back to 1863 in American Abraham Lincoln. That's the absolute last resource.
How much is your expected cost to build?
$6 billion.
$6 billion.
It's all going to be privately financed.
Okay.
And you came in later.
Yeah, I know. I apologize.
That's all right. No. We are, and it's a good way to finish this. We are asking for no federal, state, or local subsidies. It's 100% privately financed.
If you had to make an estimate as to when this will be up and running, when would that be?
Okay, I can tell you our goals. All right. The goal is to have the design submitted and hopefully approved sometime in the fall. The estimates for doing the environmental impact statement range from 14 to 22 months, which I got from my contact at the EPA, to 10 years from somebody who went through the whole 355 generation thing. So I'm just trying to do a range. I don't want, so that's the range of that. We think the construction can be done the whole route, the way we've organized it, in 2 calendar years. But that assumes that you're going to have reasonable, not blanket, but reasonable cooperation all along the route. One of the highlights of my last 5 years was a meeting that Steve arranged in Rockford. We had mayors.
Stevens.
Yeah, Stevens arranged it. Lee Hutchins was with me, so I've got two witnesses. And we had mayors from small towns, several farmers, several economic development people, and it lasted about 2.5 hours. And at the end, and I will, I've got one other closing remark, but there is no monopoly on wisdom. Guarantee you, there's no book on building a $6 billion railroad where was hasn't been built of that size in the last 100 years. And so, if anyone has any ideas, suggestions, send us an email. We'll be glad to take a look at it.
So Frank, my friend, I have a very good friend that was involved in stopping 355. You should too.
Yeah. Well, it wasn't just 355, but if you look at the major highway projects, some of the delays were just unbelievable.
Yeah.
And we hope that we won't do that, and we think because of the way, maybe I should go through this. The STB is the federal agency that approves this design. So if there are some people out there who think this is the worst idea that could ever happen, that Frank Patton is the biggest whatever, that we just don't want this, they come up to me and then I say, you are more than welcome to write a letter to the STB. And I will do the same. The STB will approve this. We want all the support in the world that we can get. But if any government official or any local official or any group is opposed to this, then they have to state their opposition to the STB. That's how it works. And because of that, we feel comfortable with our estimates.
Okay, so you've essentially made your closing remarks, right?
I have one more. I'm speaking to the students. This is a recruiting presentation. I want you students, and not just in this room, but the others who are going to see this webcast and at other universities that we know are going to see it, I want you students to stay in Illinois, Wisconsin, and Indiana. I don't want you to leave the region to find a job somewhere else. We're going to have plenty of work for everybody. The railroads, the contractors, the shippers, this whole project, we're going to need bright, energetic individuals. Cardinal George compared himself to Cardinal Bernadine and said, Cardinal Bernadine is a gentleman from the South. I am from Chicago. He was talking about a phrase that we hear a lot. It's called Chicago grit. If you want to make an impact, if you want to work on something that's going to be here, not for just generations, but for at least 100 years, we ask you to consider working on this project. And we, besides what's always mentioned is the determination and the perseverance and the optimism, if you throw in a little bit of idealism, you will not fail.
Okay, well, I think we've run out of time. Again, I expect the team will stay here. If you have questions that we weren't able to get to, please stick around. I want to thank Frank for bringing your whole team with you and supporters. And we look forward to maybe an update a year from now.
Great.
And hopefully we'll see that this thing is really still moving along. That's great. So thanks for everyone who joined us. Thank you very much. Watching this live, and yes, this will be published very soon to our website. So if you need the link, you will find it on our website very soon. The Moving Transportation Center at UIC. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I missed the beginning, and you probably talked about it, but the financing is $6 billion.
Nobody's gonna write checks. That's what he told me. I was very surprised. But, I have a granddaughter who lives in Indianapolis because of the employment of a major facility. There's good jobs out there.
Turns out that this is a bicycle.